recall, we are sharing information regarding the sanctuary, Main Paul Chapel, completed in 1935, dedicated in 1935. And last Sunday, I indicated I would talk about the chandelier. And I'm going to read you a quote from the Army Chapel magazine, April 1935. Lighting is provided by hanging chandeliers of brass. The center fixture, the fixture here, has 51 electric candles. Now I thought about that, and said, how did they come up with 51? But apparently someone decided that's what it would be, and that's what it is today. 51 electric candles. Today, there will be parish council meeting. We will have a Bible study with Chaplain Kim, and we'll also have coffee and refreshments provided by Chaplain Kim for all of us. And the way we're going to do it, we'll have the refreshments in the annex major room. The Bible study will be with Chaplain Kim in the second room as you read the main room, and the prayer council will be with the children you at that place. And finally, the rectory, make sure that you have your photo taken and the data in the directory, because next Sunday will be the last Sunday, and the data will be putting it together, and we'll be making distributions on the directory. May the good Lord and His grace to each of you. Thank you.
Good morning, Chapel Nets. Chapel, Main Coast Chapel Protestant. Good morning. That's just one of those mornings. That's it. If everyone would join me in standing up, if you're able, and we will begin the call to worship. And that is from Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 to 23. And thus saith the Lord, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And now we go to the first song, the opening hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine, number 431 in your pew hymnals. And again, number 431, Shine, Jesus, Shine.
Thank you.
courses like that that is very, very invigorating. And for example, we're going to now go into the responsive reading. It is from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. Again, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. And thus saith the Lord, for you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Finding out what is acceptable to the Lord.
And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret.
But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light.
Therefore he says, awake, you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light.
Amen. You may be seated. Now, segue to the pastoral prayer. There's already a few that we're going to pray for. One is the evacuation mission in Afghanistan for 80 seconds, as well as the allies' surgery prayer for Miss Sarah. Don't know anything beyond that. And continuing big prayers for our chaplain Davis and new baby daughter. Yeah, and what was his name? Oh, the daughter, too, because that's what we did too. The Delta variant. The chaos and panic is really going to come up the world that God will give us strength and endurance to pass through the storm time. Besides that, is there any other things that you want us to pray for? Yes, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad that we had this Lord involved in this enlisted. I think we report for this number of people out here that know this Lord involved. She's no longer in rehab, but she's been moved to the Heritage Place on Swift Street, but Hill Street. And her three children are still waiting with her until she gets her legal over a period of time.
Okay, is she, can you see where she was again?
Marcy Baldwin, she's coming back. She is in the Heritage Place, which is downtown Fifth, off Grove Street, North Cooley Spring Street. She doesn't have a phone yet, but eventually she will, but her three adult children are taking turns.
Wonderful. It's great to know that she is doing
something. She wants to thank everybody that has kept her on their burdens.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for the good news. That is good. She's got her this place and her sovereign. That is great. Great. Anything else? Yes, sir.
Yes, one of my co-workers at the Water Center, Chaplain Andy Kelly, he's one of my co-workers at the Water Center. His brother-in-law is not responsive on a ventilator due to the COVID variant right now. It's not good.
What is his name, sir?
I don't know the protocol of his brother-in-law's name, but I know my co-worker's name is Chaplain Kelly. So the whole family, he's got a wife and two kids. Okay.
The chaplain for his brother-in-law, unresponsive. I think we're going to have a couple of lives. Lord God, Jesus Christ, thank you so much for giving us another day of life, another chance to draw breath for you and your kingdom as we come together today to worship you, glorify you. And while we are worshiping and glorifying you in this fallen world, we have some requests to give to you, my precious Father. There's some things that are weighing on our hearts as well as our minds, and as our brothers and sisters around the world. We have a few prayers that we're going to do kindly lend your ear to hear from us. One being the evacuation mission in Afghanistan, the airport, 82nd soldiers, and whoever else being in that evacuation process for the Afghanis, who were the prayer, Lord, that you keep your eyes on me, as well as help for your brother-in-law, who is unresponsive at the moment, and he has a family of his own, and Lord God, we ask for saving power, if you are so willing for that family. Also pray for the Delta variants of the COVID virus and havoc and chaos still creating the world where God that you would give suffering and peace of mind and strength and endurance wherever so you deem it fit to be. Also for the hurricane and those that are suffering the path of that as well. Lord, that you would give them peace, help those who are helping them. But in other things, thank you so much for giving us things to be grateful for, such as new life, new recovery. Such examples are as far as Baldwin, who's at the Heritage Place, she's recovering. Thank you so much for that, Lord. Pray, and her family, and her adults, and we pray that there will be steady and quick recovery for them. And also for the Chapman Davis family, you being better. For all the love she brings and all the joy she brings, as well as the addition to family, and just give the family peace and strength and taking care of this need. Lord God, we bring all these things to you, knowing that you love to answer prayer. You love it. You don't just do it just to do it. You do it because you're your children. You love us. Thank you so much for listening to us, hearing us. And all glory to you. Christ, amen. And now if you would all stand with me, we will bring the ushers to the front. We will pray over the offering, to apologize, and pray it again. You will stand along with me. Dear Lord God, we pray to you again that you would take up all that you have given you, that we would use it and multiply it for your kingdom. Thank you so much that gather us here and you gather our resources together to give to you. I pray that as we give, we do it joyfully and with purpose for your kingdom. In Christ's name, I pray these things. Amen. bless us, but the Spirit's gifts may go and make them free. And in Christ's name, praise you. Amen. You may be, no, you need to be standing. We're missing one more time. The hymn of preparation, what we go to next in the hymnal, it is number 399. Again, 399, we are God's people.
So writing, it is sensitive and it means her name, in essence, means wise spirit. But again, thank you for all of your thoughts, our prayer. Please continue to keep Madonna in prayer. I will be going to the field here in the next couple of days. And so she will be at home along with 250. And the Lord is going to definitely have to be with her. So if we would now, we can go ahead and turn our attention to our text. But before we do that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time once again that we're able to assemble today and hear from you through your word. We ask, for Heavenly Father, that you would speak with. Lord, that you would speak mighty. Lord, that hearts are changed and spirits are transformed. We ask, O Heavenly Father, that we lead not as we can. And Lord, we just ask that your spirit would dwell in this place and be with us during this moment. It is in your name, Christ, we pray. Amen. In the musical adaptation of Victor Hugo's classic work, Les Misérables, some may say Les Mis, the protagonist, Jean Valjean, comes to a crisis point in his life where he becomes overwhelmed by his guilt as a former criminal and convicted felon. In a strikingly emotional scene, he's having a soliloquy there. He's actually having a conversation pretty much with himself. He asks a very penetrating question to those that may have seen the movie. And he asks himself, who am I? As he vacillates over his past, as he considers his present and looks forward into his future, he wrestles with the reality of his guilt and his deserved condemnation before man and God. He is forced to question his identity and his integrity, to reckon with the innocence of a man that was falsely accused because he looked like Jean Valjean. And though Valjean has escaped being known as a convict by changing his name and his identity, he has to come to grips with the truth about the reality of who he really is. A convict whose prison number is 24601. Many readers of this musical don't know the significance of 24601. Literary scholars maintain that Hugo assigned Valjean that number as a way to identify with his protagonist, because it signified the date on which Hugo was born, 24th of June. 1810. Hugo was identifying himself with his protagonist as a sinner, not simply from the moment that he sinned, but from the very moment of conception. Hugo would very well have had in mind David's confession. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive. However, Valjean is not alone. Most people in the world are unclear about why they are here, what they are to do, where they have come from, and where they're going. Furthermore, they hold an altogether wrong view of themselves, believing that they are fundamentally good, were born good, and that they are on their way to a good place, but that this life is the total fulfillment of their existence. There is nothing beyond this. This is where the book stops. They don't understand that they are guilty sinners, in sin, and awaiting God's just condemnation. As a matter of fact, Time magazine did an expose entitled "The Criminal Mind." Ultimately, they desire to understand the essence of criminality. Why are they like this? a criminal. And they ask the question, is man's problem his socialization? How he was raised? Is man's problem economic? How much money he has access to? Is man's problem psychological? How he thinks or how he behaves? Family, man's struggle is not that he's a criminal. Man's struggle is that he is dead. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. And you have been quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So this deadness is not a deadness in the physical. It is a deadness in the spiritual. One's body is alive. However, your spirit is dead. And this is the predicament, family, that we were all in before Christ. But praise God that God can quicken the dead to live again. Christ has taken us who were afar off, who were dead, and brought us to himself. He's made us one in himself. He's granted us the Holy Spirit. He's given us resurrection power. He's given to us the great mystery of the truth of the gospel. He's given us the truth of the church. Only through Christ are we able to be made alive. Therefore, man's salvation is an extension of God's mercy shown in his kindness towards us. And it is a result of his infinite grace alone. If I had to give you a synopsis of this message, this would be it. Man's salvation is an extension of God's mercy, shown in his kindness towards us through Christ, and is a result of his infinite grace alone. And as a result of this, there now comes responsibility. We should walk as though we have received such a grace. So we see in the first few chapters of Ephesians, we've been going through the book of Ephesians, positional truth. The resources, the riches, the things that God has done for us. He's found that he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. He's chosen us in him before the foundations of the world. He's made us to be holy, to be blameless in love. He's predestinated us. He's adopted us. He's given us redemption, forgiveness. He's given us wisdom and prudence. He's made known to us the mystery of his will. He has in the dispensation yet in the future to lift us up to higher heights than we've yet to have known. To give us an inheritance that was pre-planned before the world began. He's given us his Holy Spirit so that we can have internal fullness, the fullness of God. And he's done all of this for his own glory. He's done everything for us. The Apostle Paul transitions from those first three chapters in chapter 4 from positional truth to application. And now, here in chapter 5, he's contrasting yet again, evaluating the question, who am I? What it is like for us to be spiritually dead, or as he says here, in darkness. So let us look at Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 14. If you all did not know, you've read it already. I'm going to read it for you again. But you were sometimes darkness. Notice there, he said, you were darkness, not in darkness, but you were darkness. not. Wherefore he said, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee life. So let's look at verse number 8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but ye are light in, now light in the Lord. All his children of the light. What does he mean? The Apostle Paul clearly outlines here that what we were before we were in Christ. Darkness. What the Ephesians now are by conversion. Light. And what they should do as a result of the conversion. Walk as children of the light. This is not peculiar to the Ephesians family. We were all in this same predicament. So what does it mean to be in darkness? Darkness is the one that continues in unbelief. He is the one that has not answered the call of Christ in the gospel. When faith is called, he continues and does not believe. When repentance is called, he abides in the love and the practice of sin. When obedience is called, he remains a child of disobedience. He is not converted in mind, soul, body, and spirit. He's unchanged in heart and life. He still has a heart of soul and not a heart of flesh. Old things have not passed away. Things have not become new. I'm sure you all get what I'm saying. So what does this spiritual darkness look like? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 14. Paul gives us a glimpse. He says, the natural person, that is, the unregenerate person by nature, does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him. And he's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. The problem is not that things are over man's head intellectually. The problem is that he sees them as foolish. Watch this as we go through this. He does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, but they are folly to him. In fact, they're so foolish to him that he cannot indeed grasp them. Mind you, this is not a moral cannot, not a physical cannot, but it's a moral cannot. In other words, if you are not of God, you cannot walk as you are of God. It is an impossibility. The natural person is not able to understand, which means that his heart is so resistant to receiving them that his mind justifies the rebellion of the heart by seeing these things of God as foolish. This is a rebellion that is complete, that the heart cannot receive the things of the Spirit. This is a real inability. That is why people that are not of Christ cannot walk as they are of Christ. This is the reason why. It says in Scripture that they are not able to do good. What is good? To walk as children of the Lord. And this is man's essential problem. And the answer to the question of who he is, a sinner that is spiritually dead and not walking in darkness, rather he is darkness. Now there's another way for us to view this darkness, and the darkness has two different aspects. There's an intellectual side of darkness, and there's also a moral side of darkness. We're going to discuss those two. So the intellectual aspect of darkness is ignorance. And the second is the moral aspect, which refers to evil. darkness or moral evil. So light and darkness is in contrast both with life and behavior. Now let me give you just a few brief illustrations of this. In Proverbs, we'll see, we can't touch on all of these because it is, the Bible is replete with a lot of examples like this. But look at Proverbs chapter 6, verse 1. You'll see what I mean. For the commandment is a lamp and the law is light. Now here it is the truth that he's talking about. He's not talking about deeds, he's talking about truth. God's truth, God's word is light. Intellectual truth, knowledge. Look at Psalm 119:105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Same idea. There you see light as truth, light from the intellectual side. Now you also see 2 Corinthians chapter 4. The Apostle Paul's saying again here, talking about light and darkness. And he's talking about lost people in verse number 3. Now let's look at verse number 4. In whom? That is the lost people. In whom the God of this age has blinded the minds to the light of the glorious gospel. There it is. Here, that's where the intellectual darkness, there will be the works of that darkness. Where there is intellectual darkness, there will be works of that darkness. The next verse says, wild parties, drunkenness, immorality, shamelessness, strife, and envy. So on the one hand, you have the intellectual side of darkness. Not knowing God is true, which results in the moral side of darkness, doing the deed of the intellectual side of darkness. Amen?
In other words, what comes out of you, what is in you, will come out of you. If darkness is on the inside, darkness is going to come out. Light is also a symbol in the Bible and refers just like darkness, it has two sides. There's an intellectual side, and then there's also a moral side. So first, light refers to truth, intellectual. Secondly, moral light refers to holiness. So it is the intake and output. Intake truth, output holiness. Intake truth, I walk in holiness. So it is the intake and output. It is the truth and the life. Living in the light then means living in truth and living in holiness. Receiving the truth and living a holy life. So light is knowledge. Darkness is being blinded to knowledge, blinded to the gospel. 2 Corinthians 4:6. God commanded the light to shine out of darkness. The light has shone our hearts to give the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Light is knowledge. And darkness is ignorance, lack of knowledge. We saw in Ephesians 4 where Paul said that the Gentile mind or the pagan mind, the unregenerate, unsaved mind is darkening, it is blinding. Romans 1, it says the same thing. Their foolish heart was darkened. So light intellectually means knowledge. Now God is light. In him there is no darkness. And if you are a son of God, you are a son of light. And if you are a son of light, there is in you, should be, no darkness at all. In other words, when you were redeemed, you were fully redeemed. I do not believe that Christians should walk around in darkness. We should not resemble the world. Moving on,
Paul says that we should walk as children of the light. It is by the enablement of the light that the believer is able to accomplish the high standard of the Christian walk. It is through the power of the Spirit of God that we are able to walk as children. Children of darkness are unable to walk as children of God if they don't have the Holy Spirit guiding them and enabling them to walk as children of God. Learning to walk by the Spirit is realizing one's full dependence is supported by the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And the obstacles that we confront are massive and crumbling. As Christians live in a world system that is utterly contrary to the things of God, we see all manner of things, divisions, wars, and rumors of wars, child against mother, mother against child. We need the Holy Spirit to guide us. We are under constant influence to love the things of this world. And in ourselves, we do not have the resources to confront such a formidable foe, and we need the light to help us to navigate this life. Now, several weeks ago, we were doing a battalion team strengthening event. And they made an outline of a very large square. And half of the battalion staff stood on the inside of the square. And they took little green balls and they threw them on the inside of the square. And they said, "These green balls are the objective. We want you to pick up the green balls." And then they threw red balls in the square. And they said, "Watch out, the red balls are landmines." I said, "Well, this is easy. This is a piece of cake. I'm going to go through here. I'm going to beat everybody. I'm going to pick up all the green balls because I'll just jump over all the landmines." Simple as that, right? Not so fast. They said, "But before we start, we're going to blindfold you. And we're going to give you a teammate, and that teammate is going to help you to facilitate the red ball in order to get the green ball." Well, that complicated that. And family, similarly, we need the light in order to navigate the things of this spiritual world that we may be unable to see. Walking in the light includes depending upon God's word as providing the necessary standard of life and instruction on holy living. Christian people, we should walk in the light. Walk as children of the light. Living as children of Christ. However, living the Christian life is not just an issue of simply what you do. Far more is an issue of who you are. There are a series of inner attitudes and graces that characterize the believer. When somebody becomes a Christian, we tend to tell them that now you're a Christian, you need to read the Bible, you need to go to church, and you need to talk about Jesus and share Jesus with others. And all of that's good. That's right. But it's one step removed from the issue because those things are external. Look at what the Apostle Paul is saying here. Look, now that you are a Christian and now that you know who you are, here is what I want you to do. He talks about the enemy. Walk as children. So it all starts on the inside. The word is born. It says this. This then, the message which ye have heard of him, and declare unto you, here it comes, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. And because of that, we as children of the light have God living inside of us. And this leads us now to verse number 9. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. Notice, family, that he says the fruit of the Spirit, not the gifts of the Spirit. There are actually biblical lists of the gifts of the Spirit, also known as spiritual gifts. And there are three main passages describing the spiritual gifts. Romans 12, 6 through 8, 1 Corinthians 12, 4 through 11, and Romans 12. No, 1 Corinthians 12. The spiritual gifts identified in Romans 12 are prophesying, serving, teaching, encouraging, giving, leadership, and mercy. The list in 1 Corinthians includes words of wisdom, the word of knowledge, faith, healing, miraculous powers, prophecy, distinguishing between spirits, speaking in tongues, and interpretation of tongues. And the list in 1 Corinthians 12, 28 includes healings, health, governments, and diversity of tongues. Those are the gifts. However, the fruit of the Spirit, they seem to be sometimes overlooked because we are so concentrated on one's outward gifts. But God doesn't look at things on the outside. He looks at things on the inside. And so the fruit of the Spirit seems to be doomed in somewhat obscurity, hidden in the shadow of the more outward gifts. Yet it is the evidence of the fruit of the Spirit that is the mark of our progress in sanctification. Of course, God is pleased when we do our exercise, our gifts the Holy Spirit has bestowed upon us. But I think that he's even more pleased when he sees his people manifest the fruit of the Spirit. Paul exhorts in Galatians, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Galatians 5, 16. Again, Paul writes, for the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. Galatians 5, 17. Here is the battle. The old man against the new man. The sin nature of the flesh fights to choke the influence of the Spirit. Through this warfare, though it's internal and invisible, there are clear outward signs of the carnage wrought by this battle. When the Spirit is victorious and overcomes the flesh, we see. However, when the flesh is victorious, we see. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. What will we see if the flesh is victorious over the Spirit? Now, the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contention, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envies, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in times past, that those who practice such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Did you get that, friend? They shall not inherit the kingdom of God. This is a list of works of the flesh, and it's crucial for two reasons. First, it offers the contrast already mentioned by the fruit of the Spirit.
And second, it identifies sinful practices that the Apostle Paul emphasizes by repetition, characterizing the unregenerate and the lost. Now, you may be saying, what happens if the believer finds himself in this predicament? Sometimes a believer may find himself in that predicament. However, this should not characterize the believer's lifestyle. A believer should be uncomfortable in this sin. Because the Holy Spirit is convicting him for her. If this list characterizes the lifestyle of a person, it is the evidence that he or she is unbelieving. This is not passing judgment. This is standing in alignment with the Scripture. As believers, we have a certain lifestyle to live, and it starts on the inside. Paul sets forth the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. The fruit is designated as the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit is something that is produced in us. It is not of us. We don't do it. The Spirit does it. The flesh produces flesh. The flesh profits nothing. Martin Luther declared, nothing is not will to come. The flesh profits nothing. And he said, the fruit is this. Look at it. Goodness, first of all. And we're going to try and wrap things up here, even though I'm not going to get through all the text. We'll pick up next week where we left off. Amen. Goodness. First of all, there's a word in the Greek, kalos, which means good. It's translated good. It means free from defect and beautiful, like that of a good painter, a good cup of coffee, and a coffee drinker. Good cup of coffee is free of defects. And then there's the word tristos, which means useful. And that's good for digging a hole. Hey, that's good for holding that thing together. It's useful. But then there's a Greek word, agathosune. And it means intrinsically good. Good in nature. Good whether it's seen or not seen. Upright in heart and life. Goodness, kindness. This is the word that Paul uses here where he talks about goodness. He uses it again also in 1 Thessalonians 5:15 when he said, just do good to everybody. Look at yourself. If you're called a child of the light, you're going to walk in the light. And you're going to walk as a child of the light. Then the first thing should be goodness as it relates to others. All of you, and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. We're going to pick up next week with righteousness. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. And Lord, we thank you for your word. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you would give us strength to move throughout this week. And Lord, that you would touch the hearts and the minds of your people this week. Lord, that you would keep them protected, that you would watch over them, and Lord, that you would draw them back on next Sunday to continue to hear your word. thank you again for everything that you've done, for all that you are, and for what you called us to do. Is it your name, Christ, for you?
Amen. Amen. Pastor David, thank you so much for the word today. We will now stand at your table, and we will sing our closing hymn and end with the benedictory prayer. The closing hymn is number 90, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. And we are only going to sing verses 1 and 4. So if we're all standing constantly, we will sing that. Upon you and give you peace and go your way in peace. Amen.